मैम गुड इवनिंग.
हाय गाइस.
हाय मैम.
सो आई थिंक सर वी विल स्टार्ट सर. डॉक्टर वेंकटेश.
या आई थिंक वी शुड स्टार्ट.
गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल. गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल. वेलकम टू दिस प्रोग्राम ऑन डेवलपमेंटल पीडियाट्रिक्स इन डे टू डे ऑफिस प्रैक्टिस. एंड वी हैव एक्सपर्ट डॉक्टर रमाचंद्र मोहन प्रोफेसर ऑफ पीडियाट्रिक्स एट ICHNHC फॉर टुडेस डेलिब्रेशंस. आई रिक्वेस्टेड टू give the call.
Amal Raj, you can coordinate and do the chat box questions. Discuss.
Sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
Okay,
ma'am. Over to Rama.
Okay, madam.
Rama.
Thank you.
Good luck. Start.
Thank you. My profuse thanks to IAP and especially to Janani for getting me on board and talking about something which is always close to my heart. And normally I do the high risk follow-up of newborns in my hospital, so my lecture may veer towards that, but it can be extrapolated to the pediatric population that the practicing pediatrician is seeing also. So I'll be talking about the normal neurodevelopmental morbidities that one encounters in their clinics and what are the risk factors that we have to keep in mind which cause neurodevelopmental morbidity. How are we going to go about the follow-up? When are we going to do it and how we are going to do it and how we can do simple approaches for a community pediatrician, we'll discuss that also. So these are all the things that we are going to see in our neurodevelopmental follow-up when we do. There may be growth failure, cerebral palsy, developmental delays in general, intellectual impairment, vision and hearing impairment, behavioral problems, autism, ADHD and learning disabilities. So most babies are born healthy and they grow and develop normally through childhood. But high risk groups of babies have higher than expected rates of health or developmental problems. So the focus should be on these babies and we should have a structured and specialized follow-up program monitoring these babies. So the this is NNF clinical practical guidelines which tell us that there are different groups. So this group of babies will have a mild risk, this group will have a moderate risk and this group will have a high risk. So we have found that this is very useful when it comes to counseling parents at the time of discharge. So if you are going to show them this chart and tell them that their child comes into a high risk for neurodevelopmental delay, for example, if the child has been ventilated for more than 7 days and this child requires a continuous follow-up, I feel that we've found better follow-up rates. So parents know that the problem is severe and they come back to us for regular follow-up. So this has helped us in counseling the parents and also ensuring adequate follow-up. So what do we mean by developmental delay? So we know that when a child does not achieve the milestones which it is supposed to achieve in comparison to the peers of its own age, then we know that there is a delay. And the classification may be mild, moderate, and severe depending on their functioning. If the functioning is only affected by less than 33%, then we call it mild. If it is between 34 to 66, it is moderate. And if it is more than 66 affecting their, chronological age, then it becomes a severe developmental delay. So are developmental delays rare? No, certainly not. It affects 10 to 15% of preschool children. And when we're talking about global developmental delay, that is delays which affect more than two domains, then it affects 1 to 3% of the preschool children. So who's the one who identifies the developmental delays? They're normally identified through three major channels. That is when you're doing a routine developmental surveillance or screening, you can pick them up. Or it can be done following parental concern. Or worst situation is when it is missed in these two situations and then a teacher picks it up and brings the issue to us. So the primary care physician's role becomes very, very important because they are the people who do the screening and the surveillance. So they have to have the knowledge and skill to identify developmental delays and provide an appropriate management plan. So the plan should be in place before they go to the next referral unit. And also counseling of the parents is very important. Okay, having said this, how are we going to choose an assessment tool to pick up developmental delays, to screen for developmental delays? So here's the American Academy of Guidelines, American Academy of Pediatrics, and look at the guidelines. I mean, it's a little mind-boggling when you look at it, but these are all standard guidelines that each of them follow. But in our case, you know, there is so much of diversity, we are not able to do that. And most important difference will be whether we are going to do it in a general practice setting or whether we are going to do it in a medical college, which has dedicated specialized services, complete assessment, multidisciplinary team involvement is there. Where are we going to do the screening and where are we going to pick up the developmental delay? So our tools that we use will depend on that. So when I said developmental delay, it is not just looking at the child's IQ or looking at the child's development quotient, but it also involves checking out their physical health, their growth, doing a neurological examination, and then the developmental assessment. So we know that certain health parameters can affect the child's performance, like anemia, hip dysplasia. If it is missed, then you will never be able to make the child walk properly. So this should be have been picked up early. Dysmorphism, most of the time it may not be noticed. And any sign of intrauterine infections, which can be very subtle, may not be picked up. Metabolic disorders, we are all aware that these are ruling the roost now. Endocrine abnormalities, we saw a baby with hypothyroidism, which was picked up only at the third month and referred to us. Okay, and bone diseases. So these may be things which may be subtle and may affect the development, but may not be picked up in time. And of course, immunization must be up to date. Feeding, all of you know that feeding is very, very important, which determines a child's development. So in any of these things can affect a child's feeding, palatopharyngeal incoordination, feed intolerance, oral aversion. All of them can affect feeding, which can in turn affect growth and which in turn can affect the development. And respiratory health. So what happens is to these babies who are discharged probably after a prolonged course of ventilation, they may have recurrent reasons for getting admitted in the hospital. Some of them may be dependent on oxygen therapy at home, and this can affect the growth and development. Some of them may go on to have an hyperreactive airway, asthma, recurrent admissions, and growth failure and development being affected. Hypertension, how often do we check the BP of the child who comes for a routine examination? We do not do that. And if these babies have been an extreme preterm or an ELBW baby, then hypertension can occur as a as a precursor of subsequent cardiovascular disease. So monitoring is mandatory. Cardiac function should also be done as and when necessary. So the easiest way to keep them unchecked is to check the height, weight, and head circumference. All of us who are dealing with preterm babies will know that Fenton charts can be used till the child is around 50 weeks. Thereafter, a child can be put on the regular WHO charts. All term babies, we can monitor them on WHO growth charts. So now coming to the neurological problems as such, there is just one study which I would like to quote, which where they have done a neurodevelopmental disorder prevalence in children between age 2 to 9 years. This is the largest study which has been done in India. And they have looked at nearly 4,000 children. And the common disorders that they have looked at is epilepsy, cerebral palsy, hearing and visual impairment, speech and language disorders, autism, and intellectual impairment. And it was found that 12% of the babies had neurodevelopmental disorders, out of which 21% had two or more neurodevelopmental disorders, and autism being the most common, followed by cerebral palsy and intellectual impairment. So what were the risk factors in those cases? They found that non-institutional delivery, this is not a problem in Tamil Nadu, with more than 99% being hospital deliveries. Perinatal asphyxia was a major risk factor. Any neonatal, so whenever we are looking at developmental delays, a very important history will be their NICU stay. We have to find out how long they were in the NICU, and that is an indirect indicator of their neurodevelopmental outcome, whether there was any CNS infections, stunting, low birth weight, and prematurity. So when you look at neurological problems, the assessment is very important. However early we are doing it, it's better. Severe cerebral palsy will present very early in childhood, even by the first year of birth, with disordered tone and brisk tenor reflexes. But mild cerebral palsy may not be diagnosed till the child has started walking. So this is another disorder which may not be picked up by cursory examination. That is a development coordination disorder. You might find that there are children who keep having frequent falls, or they may be having poor coordination. So these will come under development coordination disorders. visual problems. So we know that there is a whole spectrum of visual disorders, starting from structural abnormalities to ROP, strabismus, myopia, amblyopia, cortical visual impairment. Some of them have been unearthed by the increased screen time of late. We have seen hearing problems can be structural or conductive or sensory hearing loss. There's something called an auditory processing disorder, which we should keep in mind, especially in children with cerebral palsy. So these are some of the symptoms of hearing loss in babies. In newborns, we know that when they do not smile or they do not respond to call, when language is delayed, when they do not respond to, of course, their name. And in 15 to 24 months, child's language is severely affected. They're not showing any interest in rhymes and stories. Then we have to think this child could have a hearing problem. So when it comes to cognition, this is the least recognized problem among the neurodevelopmental problems, because it might major deficits you can pick up early, but if it is a very subtle dysfunction, it may be totally missed. And unless a child has grown and the cortical, it has unfolded, we may not pick up cognitive delays. And behavioral problems, of course, they may be, you can pick up in the newborn period itself when the child is extremely fussy or irritable. But most of them can be picked up only by the second year, when the child will start showing signs of social withdrawal and delayed language development. In that case, we have to suspect an autism spectrum disorder. And later in life, ADHD and mood and anxiety disorders may evolve. So now, having seen all the various neurodevelopmental problems that a pediatrician may encounter, how often should we tell these people to come back for follow-up? So normally in the newborn period, we tell them to come back at least within a week after discharge to see whether the child and the mother have settled in the home environment. Thereafter, we ask for a 3-monthly follow-up. So every 3 months, they have to come back so that we can pick up neurodevelopmental problems earlier. And at 1 year, definitely this child should have a complete neurodevelopmental assessment. So why is there any upper limit for follow-up? Yes, these children should be followed up to 8 years of age. So till 8 years of age, you can have new problems. As I told you, behavioral problems and antisocial behavior problems, school failure, learning disabilities, these all can appear as late as 8 years of age. So after the 2-year period, I normally tell them to come back to me at the end of every birthday, so that they are under my radar till 8 years of age. Okay, now we come back to what exactly we should do. So where we are going to do it. Supposing it is just going to be in your clinic, then it is just you and the patient. But if this follow-up is going to happen in a development center, then we have the multidisciplinary team, which will consist of the physiotherapist, occupational therapist, psychologist, special educators, and then, of course, the audiologist and all that, neurologist, etc. So what tool should I use to pick up a developmental delay? So that will depend on the expertise of the examiner, the time and the resources available, and the presenting concern. So every assessor or a primary care physician should use tools which they are familiar with. Don't go just think because it's a Western tool, let me start using it. No, do something. Do a screening tool which you're familiar with, and which will give you results that are locally relevant. So how do I, so as I told you, all the problems that the child can have, how are we quickly going to assess all that? So, you know, general health, just by getting a good history, physical examination, you do an anthropometry that will give you whether the child is thriving well or not. Feeding problems by using a parent completed questionnaire, respiratory function, spirometry, and all that we can use. And then you're going to plot it in age-appropriate growth charts. Special senses, definitely these children need to have a visual and auditory functioning assessment. How are we going to do that? There are various tools. Before a child goes home, should have a hearing assessment with autoacoustic emission, should have a regular visual checkup done at least once a year by an ophthalmologist. Coming to neurological examination, there are two ways of assessing. One is Hammersmith and the other one is a Prescience general movement assessment. So this is a very, very simple format which can be used at the point of discharge of these children. For those of you who are admitting newborns in, however small the setup may be, this is a very useful tool. It is called a Hammersmith Neonatal Neurological Examination. It's a short pro forma. this has only a few items. So what are we supposed to do here? We just have to see the posture of the baby, see the reflexes, arm recoil, leg recoil, head position. Just keep plotting it. See whether the child's position is within the central three columns or within the lateral two columns. Supposing the majority of the child's findings are within the center three columns, then this child is normal. If the child's findings are within the lateral two columns, even two are abnormal, then this child definitely is going to have a neurodevelopmental problem and has to be kept under strict follow-up. Now that this is an extended version of the same thing, and this will require some more time and some training. So this is what we are regularly doing in our follow-up clinic. So it is like this. So this is, there is a scoring system where you have to see what position the child is in for each item. So the item will be given on the left side like this. Okay, 1 minute, I'll just show you. Yeah, so this item will be given here. How is the head when the child is sitting? See the head's position. Is it in the midline? Is it tilted to the back? Is it totally retracted? So depending on that, you score the child. If the child is in this position, the score will be 3. If it is here, it may be 2 or 1, and here it will be 0. So what do we do? At the end of it, you have to add up the score. So it is a simple, scorable, standardized clinical neurological examination for infants between 2 months and 24 months of age. So this has a good sensitivity, high predictive value. It is being used in all the newborn centers for predicting whether this child is going to have a neurodevelopment outcome, which is good or not. If you get a score of less than 57 at 3 months, see the such a high predictivity this child has for cerebral palsy. So it is a very simple neurological examination, which is only pictorial, illustrated. You do the test on, administer the item on the baby, see the response the child is giving, you mark it, you score it, and you can predict it objectively. So very, very well, it is very well accepted, and we are all following the Hammersmith infant neurological examination. So if the score comes below 40, then you know that this child is going to have a non-ambulant cerebral palsy. So this Hammersmith infant neurological examination has 3 parts. You have a neurological examination, developmental milestones, and behavior. The maximum score will be 78, and the minimum score will be, maybe even about 10 to 15 also you can get if the child is not performing well. But as I told you earlier, a score of less than 57 has a very high predictivity of future cerebral palsy, even at the age of 3 months. This is another simple one. I'm not going into the details of this. This requires training. You just look at the movements of the baby through the from 20 weeks of age in the newborn period, and this can predict the this also can predict cerebral palsy with an accuracy of 98%, and this requires special training, and it is also being very widely used in the neonatal period. Next is the evaluation of the tone by Amilitism, and we know that this is the angles which have been shown. And by doing these angles, you can predict whether this child is hypotonic or hypertonic. Just one word of caution, around 4 months of age, you can find that the children may have an hypertonia, which can persist up to 8 to 12 months. If it is beyond 8 months of age, then there is a poor outcome. But between 4 and 8 months, it is a variable tone. We should keep that also in mind. Then there is this gross motor function classification system, and which has been expanded now. It's called evaluated and revised. And this can be used for different age bands, for 2 to 4, 4 to 6 and all that. So this will also tell us whether this child, how the child is functioning. Okay. Now, how do I check? So you have now told me about how to do the neurological assessment, physical examination. So what about cognition? How do I do that? So for that, we need the Bayley scale of infant toddler development. And this third edition, now the fourth edition has come. So for those who are trained, especially development pediatricians, will use this to tell you what the development quotient of the child is. If the child is more than 3 years, then you use the Griffith mental developmental scale. So far, whatever I've been telling you is what can be used in a development setup, probably in a medical college or in an institute where the development pediatrician and a multidisciplinary system is there. And these are the various methods by which you can assess the intelligence of the child. This is mostly done by the psychologist or the psychiatrist. And for early language development also, we have the LEST, which is a very simple tool, which I'll be coming to next, and I'll tell you how it should be done. So when one item delay is taken as a delay, here again, the sensitivity has been found to be very high in the range of 95%. So for behavioral assessment, are there any tools by which I can check the behavioral assessment? We have the child behavior checklist, which is just a simple questionnaire by which you can pick up behavioral problems in children. Of course, the autism screener is there starting at 15 months, and that is the MCHAT revised. And then we have the Vanderbilt screening tool to check for ADHD. And adolescent, we have the HEDS framework, which I think you are better knowledgeable of than me. And quality of life, is the child able to perform activities of daily living? So that for this, we use the Vineland Adaptive Behavioral Scales from birth through adulthood. This can be used. Okay, so now these are the various tests that can be done by various specialists in the form of physio or occupational therapist. And then we do a formal developmental assessment at every year. Okay, that is DASI is the best one in the Indian context, which is developmental assessment scale for Indian infants. And this can be done, and it will give you a good DQ up to about 3 years of age. Okay, now forget about all that we have talked. If you are not part of a big institute and you only have the clinic, and you are part of a clinic and you are the only one who is seeing the patient, we'll quickly go through some simple screening tools which you can do in the busy clinic. So there are screening tools which can be given directly to the patient, or you can administer the tools, or it can be given by to the parents. So we'll look at simple directly administered tools. The simplest of the simple ones is the development observation card, where you have only 4 milestones in the form of a social smile, head control, sitting, and standing. So the ages that you have to remember are 2, 4, 8, and 12. And also make sure that the child can see, hear, and listen. So this may be very simple, but what happens is most of the time we find children being brought to us only at 1 year of age. Only when the child does not walk, the parent realizes that their child has a major problem and is brought only at that age. Till such time, they think that this child will outgrow the delay. If the child does not have a head control, they think the child will grow out of it if it doesn't sit also. So child comes only at 1 year, and we have lost precious time which we could have used for the recovery of the child. So if you're going to put up a probably a seal, make it in your discharge summary, or put up a chart in your clinic, the parent will know that the head control should have been achieved by 4 months and your child is delayed. So this is a very useful tool, especially among the field workers. Then we have something called CDC grading. You should remember that every milestone passes through different stages before it becomes mature. So the first stage in head control is brief moments of head control on the shoulder, then the baby coming up, the head coming up with the body, then in the prone position, then slight wobbling, then complete. So at 4 months, if this child is having even this achievement of this stage of head control, it is normal. But these two are abnormal at 4 months. Similarly, a child who is sitting, so this is sitting briefly, then sitting with support, then sitting with the back straight, and this child pivoting at 5 months. So when this child is these three, 3, 4, and 5 are normal at 8 months. Similarly, for standing also, the child goes through various stages where you make the child stand, and here the child is taking independent steps. So what is the interpretation of this? At this particular age, which we said so far, 4, 8, and 12, if the child is in these three grades, it is abnormal. Whereas if the child is in 3, 4, and 5, this child is normal. So this also can be used as a screening tool. So how does it help? If I'm going to write my report as the child is in grade 2 of head control, requires therapy, and I send the baby home, the child comes back after 2 months and I find that the child has moved from stage 2 to stage 4, I know that the child is getting adequate therapy and the mother is doing a good job. But if it continues to remain in stage two, maybe the child has a very severe developmental delay or the therapy is not being done properly. So that will help the therapist and me to have a common opinion about the child. So this chart, we are not using it much now, but it used to be very popular earlier. It's called a good enough draw a man test. So here the child, you tell the child above 3 years, you just draw a man and see how many parts the child is drawing. So if the child draws a face itself, he gets a three, gets 1 point. Okay, one mark is equal to 3 months. Okay, so suppose the child is drawing 5 parts, he gets 5 points. And each point is significant, is equal to 3 months. So 5 into 3, 15. So 3 years plus 15 will give you the age of the child. It's very useful and a very simple play tool which can be used as a screening test. So depending on that, depending on how many points, so we said 15. So if the child is having a score of 15, then the child's mental age will be around 6 to 9 years. There's another very simple screening chart is a Trivandrum development screening chart, which is available between 0 to 3 years and 3 to 6 years. So how do I use this chart? Okay, so here this child is 20 months of age. The child is coming to you. You enter well baby clinic. You want to do a development screening. You draw, take a scale and a pencil and you draw the age line for 20 months. Okay. And then what at 20 months you draw? Then what are the items I'm supposed to give? All the items or at least 3 items which are completely to the left of the age line. So this is 20 months of this age. So I will administer these 3 items. Walking backwards, saying 2 words, walking alone. This child is doing all the 3. So what does that mean? This child is normal. But if this child is not doing even one of these 3 items, this child is abnormal. But remember, you should only give all the items which are completely to the left of the line and not items. Sorry, the 20 months is up to this, sorry. So including this white area, 20 months will be only these 3 items, okay? 20 months will be these 3 items which are completely to the left of the age line. So walking with help, batter cake, fine prehension, pellet. So these 3 items, the child should have achieved it completely. Similarly, 3 to 6 years also. So here again, we draw the age line and give, supposing this child is 57 months of age, these 3 items this child should have completely achieved. Same with language. Similarly, this child is 18 months of age. I will administer those 3 items which are completely to the left of the age line. Now we have another very simple 10 question screen. Supposing you want to do the prevalence of developmental delay in your neighbor community. You want to do it in a corporation area or you want to do it in a village. Then this 10 question screen will be very useful, where 10 questions will pick up all the neurological disorders in that child. So you have to ask whether there is a delay in sitting or standing, whether the child can see, child can hear, is there weakness or stiffness, the child can understand what you're saying, whether the child has seizures, whether the child is able to learn new things, does he speak? So receptive hearing, expressive speech and receptive speech, and whether the child appears to be dull. So with these 10 questions, you can pick up all the comorbidities that I told you earlier. It's a very simple tool and has shown very high levels of specificity and sensitivity. Now coming to Denver, this is the tool that we are regularly using in our child development clinic. This requires a little bit of explanation and I'll spend the next 2-3 minutes on this. So here you know that each item is divided into 2 parts. You have a white part and a gray or a colored part. So this is the age at which up to 75% of the children will achieve the item. And in this colored part, 75 to 90% of them will achieve the item. So this child is coming to you at 9 months. You draw a line at 9 months, just like your TDSE. But unlike TDSE, where we did all the items which were completely to the left, here you have to administer all the items which are crossed by this line. So at 9 months, what are the items which are crossed? Drinking from cup, waving bye-bye, indicating wants, playing pataki. Okay, then how do I interpret? I have to see whether this child is passing these items. Supposing this child is not waving bye-bye. There's some disturbance. Supposing this, can I go ahead? Yeah. Supposing this child is, say this child is, this 9-month-old child is not drinking from the cup. Okay. So what do I do? See how you refer to, how do we interpret these items? So if the child is failing an item in which the age line is on the white side, I am not worried about it because only up to 75% of the children will achieve this item. But if the age line is passing through the gray area of the item and the child has not achieved it, I'm worried because 75 to 90% have achieved this item, but my child has not achieved it. So I will write C, which means caution. And if the item is completely to the left of the age line and this child has not achieved it, definitely there is a delay. So if I get 2 cautions in my Denver or 1 delay, then this child has definitely a developmental delay. No delays, child has only 1 caution, then Denver is normal and I tell them that they just have to come back for follow-up. But 2 or more cautions and 1 or more delay, this child definitely needs a follow-up. So one more screening test is the Bayley's. And the only prohibitive factor is the price. Otherwise, it is an excellent tool and it can be used for screening as well as assessment. So now we have seen all the tools which are administered on the child by the doctor. But the problem is that it takes a lot of your time and the child has to cooperate when the child is coming to you. And parents also will be very restless when you take a lot of time. So instead, we can give the parents the tool and tell them to do it and bring it to you and you can check it out. So one is ages and stages questionnaire and the other one parents evaluation of development status. So ages and stages questionnaire is a very simple questionnaire which the parent fills. So supposing you have communication or gross motor problems. So you're going to ask, does a child play with a large ball? The parent has to write yes, sometimes or no. Suppose a parent marks yes, gets 10 marks. Sometimes is 5 and not yet is 10, is a 0. So depending on the number of yeses, the child will get the score and depending on whatever you score, 10, 5 or 0. And this is how the score will be. Supposing you get a lot of yeses, the score will be high. Supposing you get majority 0, then the score will come towards the black area. And then you know that if it is in the white area, the child is normal. If it is in the black area, the child is delayed. So the advantage is that the parent is filling up. So the parent himself or herself is aware that the child has a delay. It's easier to communicate to them that the child has a problem. And the parent will also be coming back for therapy more with more conviction than when you are telling them the child is having a problem. This has been translated in Hindi and it is used in India also. And it can be given online or when the patient is waiting to come and see you, it can be done. This is a parent evaluation development scale. It is almost like your 10 question screen. And depending on these answers, once again, you plot it here and then you can get the final score. So autism screening tool, we know that this is being done, but most of them should do it in primary care. When do we do it? We should do it ideally at 18 months when the child is coming for the first booster. We have to do the checklist for autism. All of you are aware that the rates of autism have phenomenally increased in the past 1 or 2 decades. So it's a very simple tool. You just give it to the parent, tell them to answer it. Is the child? So 3 critical questions are there. That is 2, 5 and 12. So have you wondered if your child may be deaf? So these questions are. So have you wondered if your child is deaf? 5 is, does the child have abnormal movements in front of the face? And does the child get upset by everyday noises? These 3 questions alone should have the answer no. while as all the other questions should have the answer yes. If it is the other way around, okay? So if S is a typical response, no is at risk, but only for 2, 5 and 12, the answer should be no. If it is the other way around, then you will know that every question has 1 point. And if the score is coming to 0 to 2, then there is no problem. Tell them to come back after 3 months. If the score is between 3 to 7, moderate risk, they have to come back. You have to follow up with MCHAT again and start on early intervention. But 8 to 20, if it is very high risk, and the child will definitely need immediate intervention. So now, having discussed all the screening tools, what should I do? You have told me so much. What should I do now to pick up developmental delays early? In my clinic, what should I do? If you ask, you can do a Trivandrum development screening chart or an ages and stages questionnaire. If you are part of a development clinic in a tertiary care center, you can do a Denver and Hammersmith. In the community, you can do 10 question screen or a TDSC. Whatever tool you're using, let it be simple. Let it have items which are acceptable by that community. It should be done quickly and effective. It should be before the child's, child loses interest, you have to be able to do the screening tool. It should be able to pick up delay. If you're planning to buy it, it should be easy on the person, should not require much training. When the results are normal, what should I do? I can tell the parents, supposing you're overly concerned about the child, you found the results are normal, tell them that right now the child has no problem, but you do come back to me every 3 months so that we will see whether you can pick up any other problems. And if the results are concerning, we have to find out what is the reason for the developmental delay. Is it something which can be treated? Is it hypothyroidism? Is it a metabolic disorder? Is it a systemic disorder which is manifesting with developmental problems? So for all that, we need medical evaluations. Whatever is the reason for the delay, we should start on intervention as early as possible. So a screening tool is very easy to use, may not require training, but you can miss on milder delays. So for that, we need to follow. We have to have an assessment tool. We have 3 assessment tools which can be administered only by trained development pediatric or Griffith scale. So any of these 3 can be used to pick up the developmental quotient of the child. This can only be given by doing this test. So please do not use the word development quotient by just doing a screening or simply by looking at the head control and telling the development quotient is this. No, this can only be done at the end of your developmental assessment. So when you have a DQ of less than 70, the child is delayed. 70 to 85, the child should be monitored. More than 85, this child is normal. So for children who are presenting with developmental delay in the absence of any red flags and no abnormality detected on clinical examination, parents can be advised, tell them to start stimulating the child. Just because a child is having a mild delay, don't neglect it. Start on appropriate stimulation activities, and then you tell them to come back in 3 months' time and see whether they're showing any improvement. But if there is a significant developmental delay or there is a regression, loss of milestone, then definitely the child should have a visit with the development pediatrician. And when it comes to picking up developmental delays, maintain as low threshold as possible so that whenever a child has a high risk and coming with developmental delays or having chronic medical conditions, we should pick them up as early as possible and start, refer them as early as possible if you are not able to do much at your clinic level. And these patients require emotional and practical support so that they continue to come for follow-up and do not give up halfway. So just a few simple early stimulation. So supposing you're in a place where you do not have a therapist, you are just going to tell them, Thala Nikkeli, Amma Sarima, you can go and meet the therapist. They may take 3 months or 6 months to find a therapist who's suiting them. So till such time, what will they do? So head control. So simple exercises. This is called tummy time, where the child is made to lie on his tummy about 1.5 hours after a feed. This will encourage the child to lift up his head briefly, and this will improve the strength of the neck muscles. Okay, so you can even make the child sit on the lap and then the child will start holding his head. This is a very simple exercise to encourage head control. So if you want the child to roll over, make the child turn to one side, slowly flex this leg. Once he has flexed this leg, then you can pull the child that side and start helping him to roll over. Roll over requires some skill and some practice, and this can be taught to the mother, who will make it like a game and encourage the child to roll over. This is very, very important, especially in children who have visual problems. So you can just hang these things. It doesn't have to be costly. Even this gift wrapper, colored paper can be used as ribbons. You can hang it here. Or if there is something with making noise, it is better for visual as well as auditory stimulation. Let this child hold and pull. You can put these things in the wrist so that the child enjoys his own noises. Different textures can be given to the child so that the child can feel this is sensory integration you're stimulating. And then in a little bottle, you can put one finger and retrieve items or collect beads and put it into a bottle. So for sitting, how you can encourage by sitting on a bolster, making the child sit on your legs. So these are the things that we can encourage the parent to do. Here, how the child is sitting, you're improving the balance, making the child sit, and how you're encouraging the child to protect himself without falling. These gym balls will also help in balancing and making the child sit in a better way. So lying here, how we are making the child sit here within a tire, the child can be made to sit and play, or in a corner, the child can be made to sit. And this will encourage sitting, and you can massage the back so that the muscles on the back also develop. So creeping and crawling. So here, how you're encouraging, make the child flex. See, this is how you're making the child balance his trunk so that the child can move forwards. So they're very simple exercises. We can demonstrate it. We ourselves can do it so that you can you get confidence in teaching the parents what to do. So what is my take-home message? The developmental delays are common, and it can involve either a single domain or multiple domains. Early identification and appropriate management will definitely improve the child's development. Primary care physicians play a very, very important role in identification of developmental delays through a developmental screening. So all of us should be familiar with at least one development screening tool. You can even train the staff nurse or whoever is helping you to do the screening, and then so that they can pick up developmental delays as early as possible. So start them on appropriate stimulation activities. Keep the child under monitoring. Tell them to keep on coming back to you every 3 months so that there is no worsening. And then when it comes to referral, don't have any ego. Start referring them. Even if it is you're having a small doubt, you send them to a specialist so that they are picked up earlier. And so they are also, you know, even when there is a mental health problem, these children should not be ignored. They should be referred as earlier as possible so that you can get maximum and optimum development of the child. So before I wind up, I just want to inform the audience that there's a neurodevelopmental workshop on 22nd October. This is part of our state neonatal conference, which is on, the conference is online, but the workshops are physical. And this is going to be in ICH. For those of you who are interested, you can visit the website TNDG Neocon and register for this conference. So thank you. For those of you who are having any doubts, you can contact me on email or feel free to visit our child development clinic at ICH. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rama Chandrabhogan. That is a lucid presentation about developmental pediatrics in day-to-day practice. I think must be useful to all primary care pediatricians. I think there are one or two questions in the chat box. I just see.
No questions, sir.
No questions, sir.
I think somebody has asked about ages and
stages. ASQ chart. I think there is a question about ASQ chart.
Yeah, ages and stages questionnaire. It can be started as early as 2 to 4 months. Everything has a bracket. So we have questions for children starting at 2 months. At 2 to 6 months, we'll have one package. Or 6 to 12 months, we have some package like that. So it happens at regular intervals. The different charts are available. And it is very easy because it is parent-based. But only thing is we find that our parents are normally, they want to think that their child is normal. So you may have a little bit of discrepancy between the parents' reports and our observation.
There's another question. What age we can use HANE? Is it 2 months or 3 months?
We can use it from the second month onwards. Hammersmith neonatal neurological examination is the only one which is used in the neonatal period. Thereafter, we can use it at any age up to 1 year. What we do is we are doing it at every 3 months. We do it at 3, 6, 9 and 12 months. And then, if, as I told you, any score of less than 57 alone, we have to be on guard. And let me tell you, it is very simple. If those of you who are interested in knowing how to do a Hammersmith examination can go to www.hine.org. That is a website. If you register there, videos are available. You can see how each should be done. Each item can be administered. Videos are there. How to score. The forms are available. So you can very easily, you can... what shall I say, make use of it and make it part of your clinical examination. It takes you just about 5 minutes to do the neurological examination and it is very objective.
Dr. Rishikesh has asked, while considering the growth, do we need to take corrected gestational age or chronological age?
Definitely, we have to use the corrected age. I'm very sorry if I have not mentioned that during my lecture. Both for physical as well as for neurological examination, we have to take the corrected age into consideration. But only thing is, for physical, the child tends to catch up very fast. So, head circumference and all may catch up even by 6 months. So that is not much of an issue. Whereas for neurological examination, definitely we should give allowance up to 2 years. We should correct for prematurity.
Dr. M.S. Viswanathan has asked, any particular suggestion to stimulate normal development in children with chronic illnesses?
Stimulate normal development, as I told you, that the children are asked to come at 3, 6, 9 and 12 months. Okay, so supposing a child is coming to you at 3 months, the next milestone that the child has to get is head control. So what I tell them to do is tummy time. So when they go home, they tell them to do tummy time. That is 1.5 hours after a feed, put the child on the tummy. Okay, keep the child in that position till the child becomes uncomfortable. That is a very good exercise to stimulate head control. Or put the child on your lap and keep the child facing you. Hold the child's head or neck from the back. Okay, so child's head will shake for some time. Over a period of a few days, the mother will notice that the child's head control is better and better. Okay, now the child is coming to you at 6 months. Next milestone is sitting. How do I encourage sitting? Either you can make the child sit in a corner or make the child sit on your lap without leaning on your chest. Move the child in front, okay, away from your chest and make the child sit. So slowly the child will start sitting independently. And that is then 9 months you go to standing. For standing, of course, you have to stand next to the child, hold the child. So that way we have to do very simple exercises which will help to stimulate. And please, very important message I want to give is to reduce the time spent on the phone. I find that children are requiring the phone even to feed. They don't know what they are eating. They just look at the phone and mechanically swallow the food. Instead of that, the child can be encouraged to appreciate the food, the items that the child is being fed, so that taste, smell, all those things will be appreciated. Okay? Any other questions?
That is our request to send your email ID.
I'll type it here.
The developmental pediatric workshop also somebody has asked that details. Yeah.
I don't know if it is full already. We are only encouraging about 30 people because we are having a hands-on in the afternoon. Oh. So please, details of development workshop, how do I share that?
No, I think they can send an email. Your email address. They can send a request to your email.
Okay. DigiNeocon. This is the website. DigiNeocon 2021, if you go to the website, all the details are there. Even the conference, the registration is only 500 rupees. 4 hours on Saturday, 4 hours on Sunday. It will be very useful to a practicing pediatrician. We have chosen only neonatal topics which are useful for a practicing pediatrician. So please go to the website and register and benefit from the conference as well as the workshop. We are having 5 workshops throughout Tamil Nadu, only one in Chennai, which is the neurodevelopmental workshop. So email of HINE is .hine.org. So Hammersmith is very, very useful. After all these years of training in pediatrics, I found that there is a structured neurological examination for infants and newborns is Hammersmith. It is being used throughout UK. And now it is being used by all neonatologists here, and pediatricians have also started using it. Very, very simple. Picture is there on the side. How to do that item is also there. You just have to do it and plot which picture you're seeing. Child's head is straight or like this or like that. Just mark it. The score is on top. It's very easy to do it. And I encourage all of you to do it. So let us all have a common format of doing the neurological assessment as pediatricians.
Thanks again for sparing your valuable time on a Sunday evening.
It was such a pleasure talking to all of you. And
Thanks, Rama. It was wonderful. Thanks.
Dr. Janani, closing comments.
I'm outside. I'm just coming home.
Yeah, I can see.
Thank you. Thank you, Rama. It was very nice.
Amal Raj is there. Amal Raj.
Yes, sir.
Please give a comment, sir.
Yes, sir. It was very joyful, sir, to see Madam. She's been my teacher during my PG days. It's always a pleasure watching a lecture, and I've learned a lot of things. In fact, all of us would have learned a lot of new things from her. She made it very simple and very crisp. I think it will make a huge change in our practice also, sir. Thanks a lot, madam. Thanks a lot, madam.
Thank you.
Thanks to all. Thanks to all the delegates who have participated today. Thanks to all.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Rama. Bye.
Thank you, madam. Bye, madam.